5 most common fraud claims that I personally have seen being over a decade in the insurance industry. The number one is the vehicle registration. If you own the car and your name is on the title and it's registered to you, you are the only person that can insure the car. You can put as many drivers on the policy as you want. That's not a problem. They'll let you pay as much as you can. But the case is, if you're the owner, you need to insure it. You can't put it under somebody else's policy. Now, there are some caveats where the legal guardians can, in most cases, have them listed on the policy. And that's more of a company per basis. But 8 out of 10 companies are going to say, no way, unless your parents are added to the registration, then you can't have that insurance. You have to have your own. That's just because the law is you can't make a profit on insurance. And if I didn't own the car and you paid me for the claim, I'm making money. Am I gonna hand it to you? Probably. But if I walked away with the money because it's my insurance policy, I'm claiming the car, I can walk away and never say anything to you. And in that situation, I have made a profit, and that is illegal. That creates a fraud profile. And in a moment, we'll talk about what happens when you get on the fraud list and why you don't want to be on it. If you guys are shopping for better rates, I've got a link to a company below. Feel free to check them out. It's Cover Insurance, and they are one of the best companies I've worked with. They 30 plus companies. There's a link there below. Teens are the second most common. When you have a teen and they turn 16, in most cases, when they turn 15, they get a permit and you list them as a non-driver on your policy. Well, a non-driver technically means a non-driver, but in these cases, when they're teenagers and their learner's permit, they're a permitted driver. And so you're gonna list them as a permitted driver and have them rated on the policy. Well, the rate is zero. It doesn't cost anything to have a permitted driver, so it doesn't hurt you. What that's doing is that's essentially setting a trigger for the company or the underwriter to go back into that file once that date of birth for that permitted driver hits 16, and they're gonna follow up probably within a few months to verify if they've gotten their license. If they have, they need to go on to your policy or they need to go off and get their own policy. Most people in the household kind of shy and hide the fact that they have teenage drivers, mainly because the cost is ridiculously expensive. Anywhere from $100 to $300 a month extra to have a young driver. They're the highest risk there is. They're learning to drive, so the risk is very high. Now, other companies have rebutted that to fight back and give money back to the client because they don't want to lose mom and dad in the whole policy if it's a good risk. So they're adding teen safe driving systems, smart driving courses that they can take to get discounts. And I've seen policies where that teenage driver didn't actually even add that much after they've done all of the options. They can have a higher deductible in some cases. So depending on the company that you go with, they offer different plans and different programs and different usage base for that teen. That's one way to kind of open that up so you're not trying to hide non-drivers off of the policy. The third one is more home-based, is you're claiming items that you don't own. If you have a fire, a theft, vandalism, whatever the case is, you might say, oh, I had a laptop in my car, or oh, I had this, or oh, I had that in my house, and I had a ping pong table that was $800, and you might have sold it at a garage sale. We don't know, right? You have a receipt for it, but now you're starting to claim that. And that's a big, big thing against fraud. If you get caught with that and fraud is stamped on your name, it's going to hurt you drastically. More to come on that because I actually have an example of a customer that I worked with that got stamped as a fraud claim and it was not good. Just don't claim it. If you don't own it, if it's something that was sold or whatever the case is, follow through, treat the company just normal, claim what you have. If you're not sure, then let them know, but they'll probably let you claim it anyways. They're usually okay with having all of that stuff piled up and not necessarily be exact. I had these paintings, I had this thing, I had that and whatnot if there's a claim. In the situation of a car, there's usually not a whole lot of damage. It's just the car in most cases, maybe an extra $500 or $1,000 worth of a laptop or whatever the case, depending on your coverage, you have that available too. And they're gonna make you prove a lot of that stuff with receipts or with proof of purchase if they feel that it is possible fraud. In those situations where there's small increments, they might just deny that part of the claim and not necessarily stamp your file as fraud, but just be careful because they have full rights to do so. The fourth way is rate or exclude. You have the choice in most companies to either rate a driver or exclude them from the policy. sounds good, but if you exclude somebody, they never can drive your car. The insurance company technically doesn't care because if they drive your car, not covered at all. The loan company would care if you have a loan because now you're choosing not to let them be covered. If you exclude somebody, usually it's because of cost. The cost is too high for a 16-year-old, so we're just going to say they're never going to drive my car, excluded from my policy. If they drive the car, crash it, it's completely not covered at all. If you rate them, you have the opposite happen. They're now covered on that policy as a driver. Once again, we said you can have as many drivers as you want. So now that they're a driver on that policy, you have to pay that premium based on their risk. If they have a ticket, if they have a claim, anything in the last 3 to 5 years, that's gonna fall onto your insurance policy. It's not so bad because they don't necessarily rate it as heavy as if you were the person that had that issue, but additional drivers can affect those rates. So let's dive into the fifth one, and this is the actual claim that I had to file, and it turns out after an investigation, it was a fraud claim. What had happened was a customer of mine, we'll call them customer ABC, and they bought a vehicle. They had it insured for several years. They had jewelry. They had the house. They had the whole nine yards. Looked like a great client. Several thousand dollars. It was expensive. They added a teenage driver, and it overall was just a typical policy. Now, they were paying quite a bit of premium, and that person had gone through more of a financial and a struggle family-wise, ended up splitting away from their spouse. In that scenario, they had already frauded me because they said they were single from the beginning. And they weren't separated at the time, they were married. That spouse actually lived in the house, had a car, we were insuring the car, but the spouse probably had some sort of claim or ticket, and the several thousand dollar policy probably would have doubled in that case. So let's hide that person down, let's move them aside and pretend that it's okay. It's not gonna be okay, because when that person gets in an accident and we find out they're the driver, you're married to them, and that scenario has happened, now you're gonna be fraud. That's actually not what triggered it. What happened was they came out and said, oh, I'm separated now. So now it didn't really matter as much because they were getting their own policies. Spouse was off in a different house. And what was happening was that person was supposedly selling a vehicle to the spouse. The spouse is purchasing it, we're switching the title over, it's going to them, and they didn't tell us this. This is how we found out that they had a spouse in the first place and that they were separated. Customer ABC took the vehicle off of their policy, said, I sold it, it's gone, thank goodness. A week later, we get the vehicle added back to the policy. That was a little bit odd, but they said the sale fell through. What ended up happening was the spouse, who wasn't officially separated yet, had gotten into a major accident with the vehicle. They put it back on the other person's policy, they insured it, waited a couple days, filed a total loss claim. Most people, that is a trigger to tell us, hey, something happened. What happened was the fact that the vehicle left, then it came back, the registration, they can look that up, people. It never changed. So it was like, oh, who's customer, da, 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 da. And, oh, that's my spouse. Well, you said you were single. Oh, no, we're separated. Oh, well, where's he living? Oh, we're supposed to rate for that. Oh, here's the scenario. And so there's all of these like diving in and investigations that happen. It doesn't happen overnight. It could take a few months to process. Once that has processed, that customer, oddly enough, it was still insured with the company that I was with at the time, and they didn't kick her out, but what they did is the rate went skyrocket. I'm talking it almost tripled. The claim was denied, so the vehicle itself got taken off, and they didn't even allow that claim to go through. You can try to sue them if you want, but you're probably gonna lose that case. We had the recorded call because most insurance agents are recording their calls for E&O purposes. That way it's errors and omission. If I tell you something wrong, I have to legally cover that piece, and we have insurance for ourselves that if we say something wrong, then the insurance is gonna pay because we, just like you, don't have $1 million just sitting in our wallet to pay that person. In that scenario, she got denied completely and she got stamped as fraud. How did I know this? Because we got the paperwork in an email saying fraud claim, they file a fraud claim with the state, and now on your name, you have fraud. You can no longer work in the insurance industry. You can no longer work in a financial industry where you're handling people's money personal security, any of that. If you have any type of fraud, when they do a background check, they're going to notice that there's fraud on your name. Unless you can dispute it and get it off, there's no way that one of those high pay, high amazing jobs, if you want them, are going to be available to you. If that's not a worry, then great, that's all power to you. But that can go worse. If somebody were to get injured in that case, now you've got a lawsuit against you and you lost everything that you've earned, or at least a chunk of it every single year is coming out of your income, where you're paying that back to someone that you could have potentially injured. Also, you could get jail time. Fraud is fraud, man. It's like, go watch The Wolf of Wall Street. It's no different than him making a fake company to sell stocks. They sell him through his company that makes a commission that turns around and buys him somewhere else. And then he went to jail for however many years he went to jail for. It's just fraud. That's just the way it is. He can't go back into that industry, at least with the company, and be legitimately taken seriously or even worked with. Those are the top five frauds that I have personally seen, the process that it goes through, and the outcome that it can be. It's not the end of somebody's life. It's definitely a depression for a few days or a few years, but it's something that if it happens, you made a bad mistake. That's not even the end of it. I've seen other people where they've stolen their own cars, chop shopped it, claimed it on insurance, and then found it magically. They're going to check into things like that. Be careful if you are thinking of it. It's not worth the risk. Let me know in the comments below what you've seen in the past. I'm curious if you've had any other experiences, or maybe you got mistaken for that situation. I would love to hear how you got out of it or how it got fixed in your scenario. In the meantime, if you're curious about different claims or different ways to get better rates on insurance, go ahead and check my insurance video on how to get the best insurance from your phone. It's definitely worth a watch. It'll save you probably hundreds of dollars if you're one of the good fits for those situations. I'm Mark with Think Insurance. I'll see you in the next one.